Koby's the general manager of the Cleveland Cavaliers. During his first season as GM in 2017 and 2018, he helped lead the team to their fourth consecutive NBA Finals. So you played basketball at Middlebury, but you didn't go right to basketball. You went first to do real estate investing. How did you make that transition from Middlebury to real estate, but then importantly from real estate back into sports?
So when you graduate from these schools, and Middlebury is a top five school in the country, I'd like to say, definitely top five liberal arts school. You think you have to go make money. Like, to justify the education, you got to go make money right away. And I went into commercial real estate, and my first 3 months on the job, I sold a 16-unit building in Brooklyn and got a really nice commission. And I said, man, this is great. I'm going to stick around for a little bit. And but I missed being, like, all you guys, like, you're passionate about your businesses, and I'm passionate about basketball. So I missed being a part of that and being around it. And I sort of snuck off to Xavier High School, which is on 16th Street. My office was on 20th Street. And I would tell my boss I'm going to check out some real estate, but I was really sneaking down to go help the freshman basketball team out for an hour a day. And that really piqued my interest. And I said, this is what I need to be doing for a living.
So you go into coaching, and then you go into management. Your first job with the Cavs was player personnel, which is really evaluating talent. How do you evaluate talent? What's your philosophy around evaluating talent, both with players, but also with the teams that support you?
Sure. I think so talent's really, really important, and especially in the basketball realm, like, talent, the best talent wins. But what I try to find in players and coaching staff, performance staff, my front office, like, I want people with great attitude. So those are sort of the non-negotiables now as we're starting to form this thing and recreate our culture, is people with great attitude, great work ethic, and people that really want to be in Cleveland. Like, that's very meaningful. And so when you're sort of recruiting your talent bases, they have to check some boxes for you. And those are the boxes for me. Like, you have to have a great attitude and show up to work every day with positive energy. That's going to affect the group. And that's from a player to the coaches to everybody. And then work ethic. I mean, we have to work our asses off. It's a tough job. And bring that every day, and really want to be in Cleveland, Ohio. I think that's also really important. I think you want to be a part of the mission that you're on. And so if you're ever in an interview, I think it's meaningful when someone says, I really want to be there. I want to be there with you and your company. And I think that's really important. And I think we want, we say it all the time, we want fountains, not drains, right? And so we want givers, not takers. And a drain, we all know what a drain is. A drain can suck the energy out of a company, it can suck the energy out of a room, and certainly one player can suck the energy out of a locker room. And so you want fountains, not drains. And so if everything's equal, I'm going for that great attitude.
So we hear a lot in baseball about things like Moneyball and sabermetrics. What's the analogy around talent evaluation in basketball, and how do you use data? How do you use the data to evaluate players beyond what you just see with your eyes?
Yeah, so we have so much data. And we're really fortunate. Our chairman is Dan Gilbert, and very, very tech-driven owner. And he likes to say all the time, you know, so Quicken Loans is the number one mortgage lender in the country now. And he likes to say that he's a technology company that just happens to give mortgages. And so we sort of envision ourselves the same way, like, we're a technology company that just happens to play basketball. And so we're very tech driven and very much data analytics. But so there's data to actually evaluate players, to make decisions, to forecast contracts, where we're trying to find that other, say, percentage points here and there is in the performance data. Mm-hmm. And in this, where we are now is we're sort of in a growth phase of our business almost and our team. And so I'm obsessed with player development and growing our young guys. Our best assets right now are our 18, 19-year-old kids. I can call them kids. So what am I putting around them for them to be successful, for them to be their best selves? And it's not just basketball, right? It's like a nutrition plan that they wake up to every morning. They have a breakfast at 9 a.m., and then they have a shake after practice, and then they have a sleep recovery plan. Like, all that stuff I put around a 19-year-old to help them be successful, to create a routine. And so the nutrition plans, strength and conditioning plans, recovery plans, and it's all data-backed of why this is successful for a kid. A quick story just to tell you what we're going through right now, and it's a fun time because we have young athletes now that I'm excited about that are talented. We had two summer leagues. We had a summer league in Utah, And this is one of our young kids. I'm not going to mention his name because I don't want to put him on blast too much. But just to give you some perspective of their age and their innocence, really. One of our kids, we'll call him John. So the bus is going to take us down to practice in Park City. Beautiful. We're at the St. Regis, right? And everyone's blown away. And he's not late, but he's waiting for the bus outside the bus. And so I wasn't there. So one of our coaches goes up to him and says, "Why aren't you getting on the bus?" He's looking at his phone. He's looking at his clock. He's like, "Man, I'm just waiting for my Wendy's Uber Eats. It's just down the mountain." And so there's a few things there, right? The time management wasn't great, right? But two, he's eating Wendy's, right? He's eating Wendy's. There's a guy that's going to make millions of dollars, and he's eating Wendy's. And so I went up to him after the practice and said, "Well, what are you doing?" And he said, "Well, it's only my first time like eating Wendy's since I've been here," and we'd only been there 2 days. But in college and high school, they eat junk food, and these are the best athletes in the world. So how do we get that percentage point? How do we get that percent? Well, they start eating the right way. They start sleeping the right way. And you start surrounding them with people that are going to put them in a routine that they can be successful with. And so that's what I'm really excited about in terms of the data that we have now for setting these kids up for great success, like from a performance standpoint.
So you talk about the data in evaluating the talent, probably valuing the talent to sign them, and then all the performance and training. Yeah. Where does the line draw, or does it draw, from GM to coach in terms of using that? At what point do you say, actually, all of our analytics say that this guy's the best in the fourth quarter, so we want you to play him or him, them? And is there a demarcation point, and how do you coordinate with the coach?
It's really an exciting time for us in terms of all the stuff we have. You don't want to inundate your coach with too much, but what we have done is we move one of our – and the things that have grown the most since I've been in the NBA are the analytics departments. Like, they've just grown immensely. And every decision we make is data-backed. And so there's a gut instinct. There's obviously a visual. There's intel. I mean, there's sometimes I think I'm half CIA in terms of collecting real information that you have to make, you know, million-dollar decisions on. But the data is really important. So we move one of our top analytics guys who had a really good rapport with players. We moved him to the coaching staff. And so now he sits behind the bench, and he also is in game planning, and he's in strategy sessions. And so literally, instead of us just sort of saying, "Hey, we see this, take a look at this," we have him now entrenched within the coaching staff. And so there's real live-time stuff that goes on during a game in terms of, you know, best five-man lineups, best three-man lineups, how we're doing. But it's just all part of a process of how we're learning how to use this data on the fly.
So you go from player personnel, where you're purely evaluating talent, to GM. How do your responsibilities increase, and then how much involvement do you have in the business side?
too much involvement on the business side. It's like you get further and further away from what the job ultimately is. My job is to evaluate talent and bring the best players to Cleveland. That's my job at its core. But then you have to manage a lot of different parts of that. So there's the coaching staff, there's the performance staff, then you have the media side, then you have your front office and your scouting staff. And it's a lot of layers that you have to figure. That's the hardest part of the job, is really figuring out how to communicate that plan on down so we can all be on the same page. But from a business standpoint, we want to make sure our brand is right. Who are we marketing? You know, what bobblehead night it's going to be, like that sort of stuff. I gotta figure out. It takes you further and further away. But it's also really, really important. And we're opening up the Rocket Mortgage Fieldhouse this year. It's a brand new renovation. And so rolling that out to our fan base is really important. And making those appearances is really important, as much as I want to be at a college basketball game scouting.
Right. What's the most rewarding part of the GM job? And what's the most challenging or frustrating part?
Yeah, I think you guys scale your business. Like, we're growing rapidly. And to empower people to make real decisions and get better at that craft is really cool for me. And so, you know, we did a lot of heavy lifting this past summer. We added a new head coach in John Beilein, who is from Michigan. And we're really trying to work hard to create the culture that we want to be a part of. And so that's exciting for me. That's exciting for me. To give you a little background, when I got the job, I was literally thrown into the frying pan. Like, we had come off three finals, three straight finals, and the general manager at the time, David Griffin, who's a mentor of mine as well and influential in my life, him and ownership couldn't come to an agreement. And so they parted ways, and then number two also parted ways as well. And so number three, assistant GM, was sort of there, and everyone in the building was looking towards me for leadership. And so we called Dan up. I said, look, Dan, totally get it. I don't pretend to know what went on in the negotiations, but I got you. Like, we'll take care of this for you. The draft's a week away. Free agency's 2 weeks away. And our all-star point guard, you know, also demanded a trade. So those three things happened exactly as I was taking on the job. And before I even got the job, I said, we're going to navigate through this, and whatever happens, happens, but I got you. And so that was a crazy time of just, all right, let's keep the pieces together. And we still have LeBron James, so we're really good. And so got to get back to the finals. And so this year's the first year I feel like we can finally get our hands around sort of creating our own culture and creating what we want to be about, as opposed to that four years in a row of finals where you're like, you got to get back to the finals. Don't worry about the future. Forget about all your draft assets. Do everything you can to get back. And now we're trying to set it up for sustainable success and recouping some of those assets we lost. And so
trial by fire couple of weeks, clearly.
Not fun.
But you ended up, you know, four straight NBA finals. And now no playoffs, no LeBron, no Kyrie. And so you're embarking on a different phase. How do you manage that transition? How do you keep people inspired and motivated? How do you think through that?
So we don't have the expectation for anything short of being really bad. So that gives me a chance. we're picked 29th to finish 29th this year, and there's only 30 teams, so you do the math. but that's great. That's when you can grow your business, right? Now, like, I'm not under the radar. We're sort of over here, which is great. And now I can do some of the innovative, creative stuff I really want to do. I can put people in place. I can surround the building with people that are going to be super positive and going to grow our young talent. And to use the word, I have a lot of air cover right now. Mm-hmm. And we're going to, you know, I love to under-promise and over-deliver. And we're slowly going to tangibly show results. And it's the bigger picture is the 3 to 5 year plan, not so much this year. And so we're going to find small victories every day. And before you know it, we'll get back there. I have no doubt with the young talent that we have flexibility, we have cap space, we have one of the best owners in sports that gives us all the resources in the world to be great. So we're gonna get there, and we have air cover right now, and so before you know it, we'll keep climbing.
So it's a fascinating, we talked about this a bit yesterday, the benefits of being number one and being in the finals all the time, but it brings a bunch of stress to it versus the lack of pressure necessarily being down here and growing. Most companies or entrepreneurs go about it the other way. They start as the scrappy one and then they get to the top. You went to the top and you're scrappy and you're gonna get back your way to the top. Which one's more fun? And how do you motivate and inspire everybody to be with you along this journey?
Yeah, so don't get me wrong. Those 4 years of finals and a championship was really cool. So, it was amazing. So don't, like, and I have a championship ring that I will never, you know, it's still to this day, it's still just gives me shivers. But it's a different challenge. It's a different challenge, and I'm excited about growing the business and growing our players and our staff, and it's fun. I think this part of it's fun, and so I'm excited about this new challenge, and. You know, we'll see. And then the second part of your question was
how do you get people to buy in for the ride? If you may not be, you know, it may be more than, hopefully less than 35 years, but maybe more than one.
So I think surrounding myself with people that want a diverse and really dynamic talents, but they're all about the growth phase of this. You know, during that 4 years final run, it was a different goal. It was get back to the finals, and so different cast of characters for that kind of team. For this team, we need people that have patience, that want to grow, that are teachers by nature, that want to help us succeed. Really, like I said, like, really want to be in Cleveland, Ohio, and help us grow this thing. And so that's the sell point. But usually, I'm not selling. Usually, it's people that see the vision and they want to be a part of it, and drive cross country to be in Cleveland, Ohio for our mission.
So you got the great opportunity to rebuild the team, almost starting from scratch. And alongside doing that, build a culture. And how important is that? You talked a little bit on the at the outset about it kind of being a tiebreaker, but as you're looking for players, drafting players, signing free agents, clearly the wanting to be in Cleveland is part of it. But what else are you looking for around culture, and how do you put all the different pieces together to get the right mix?
So we're still evolving as a culture, and especially with our new head coach, and we're sort of trying to be aligned in what we're doing. I do know one thing that I want to make sure that over the next 3 to 5 years that everyone sees out of our organization is you can come to Cleveland and find your best self, whether you're a player, a young player, or a veteran player that prolongs his career, or you're a coach that wants to get better, or you're a front office person that wants to achieve more, a performance team. We want to create have the resources and environment that you can come in and find your best self in Cleveland, Ohio. And in 3 to 5 years, we hope that's going to be the narrative. And so just putting those building blocks in place now and have a foundation for that moving forward is really what I'm trying to achieve.
Let's pivot back to you personally. You're an African-American general manager. You're a Jewish African-American general manager, which is a rare combination, I would think.
Sure.
I'm not sure, are you the only Jewish African-American general manager in the NBA?
Probably, yeah. There's only 30.
But what's it like? What's it like being a minority in the upper echelon of management in the NBA?
The visibility of it's a big deal. So me sitting in this seat means a lot for future minorities and women as well that want to sit in this seat. And to be able to make transformative hires is a big deal. You know, we hired the first time in the franchise history, we hired a women's assistant coach to be on our staff. And her name's Lindsay Gottlieb. She's phenomenal. And it wasn't a check-the-box hire. She was really good. She was the head coach at Cal. And she'd been to a Final Four as a head coach from the Pac-12. And so we had to really recruit her. I mean, this was a sitting head coach. And right now I'm seeing unbelievable things out of her and how she's connecting with our rookies. And it's just really cool to see. And it's organic. It wasn't forced. But to have that diversity in the room is a big deal, and when you're looking to make your hires as well, you gotta look from a much bigger lens and try to put people in a position to be successful. And I think diversity and diversity of thought is a big part of that. But now to answer your question, there's only 30 of these things, and to be a general manager and a black general manager, I think is a huge deal, and I have to succeed right for the future. Yep. of this position.
Thank you. Thanks for being here, Koby.
Thank you.